welcome to Learning English, a daily 30-minute program from the Voice of America. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter, Jr. This program is designed for English learners, so we speak a little slower and we use words and phrases especially written for people learning English. Today, you will hear stories from Anna Mateo and John Russell. Later, we hear an everyday grammar lesson all about conditionals. Finally, Ashley and Katie Weaver finish their national parks journey with a visit to the Great Smoky Mountains. But first,
miners in Botswana recently unearthed what officials say is the second largest diamond in mining history. The country's president, Mokgweetsi Masisi, presented the large stone to the public at a ceremony last week. The 2,492-carat gem is the biggest diamond to be discovered since 1905. The diamond weighs around a half kilogram. Masisi was one of the first people to get to hold it. He expressed surprise at the diamond's heaviness and told the gathering, "I am lucky to have seen it in my time." Lucara Diamond, a Canadian mining company, found the stone. Company officials said it was too early to value the gem or decide how it would be sold. A smaller uncut diamond from the same mine in Botswana sold for a record $63 million in 2016. Nassim Lahri is a director with Lucara's Botswana team. "This is history in the making," she said of the new find. "I am very proud. It is a product of Botswana." Lucara said in a statement last week that the company recovered what it called an exceptional diamond from Karaway Mine in central Botswana. Company miners used X-ray technology that is designed to find large, high-value diamonds. "We are ecstatic about the recovery of this extraordinary 2,492-carat diamond," Lucara President and Chief William Lamb said in a statement. The weight would make it the largest diamond found in 119 years. It also is the second largest diamond ever mined, after the Cullinan diamond. That 3,106-carat stone was unearthed in South Africa in 1905. The Cullinan was the source of several famous cut gems, including some among the British crown jewels. Botswana, a country of 2.6 million people in southern Africa, is the second biggest producer of natural diamonds behind Russia. The Karaway mine has produced four other diamonds over 1,000 carats in the last decade. Before this discovery, the Sewelo diamond, which was found at the Karaway mine in 2019, was recognized as the second biggest mined diamond in the world at 1,758 carats. French fashion business Louis Vuitton bought the diamond. The sale price was not publicized. A British jeweler bought the 1,111-carat Lesedi Larona diamond, also from Botswana's Karaway mine, for $53 million in 2017. A Karaway diamond named the Constellation is the holder of the record $63 million sales price. Diamonds form when carbon atoms are pushed close together by intense pressure conditions deep underground. Scientists say most diamonds are at least a billion years old, and some of them more than 3 billion years old. I'm John Russell.
It is after midnight when the windshield fogs up on Thomas Acock's pickup truck. He smiles as he slowly drives through the sawgrass and down dirt roads deep in the Florida Everglades. His foggy windshield confirms what he knows. When the dew point drops in the middle of the night, it is perfect time for pythons. "I catch more pythons when that happens," Acock said. The retired U.S. Army veteran always takes part in the Florida Python Challenge. The Wildlife Commission runs the 10-day event. The aim is to get people interested in finding and catching the snakes. There is a reason for the timing of the event. Pythons usually hatch from their eggs each August before finding their way into the swamp. Acock works for the Florida Fish and Wildlife Conservation Commission. He has hunted Burmese pythons in the Everglades for 11 years. Acock loves snakes, and he loves preserving the Everglades. He understands the greater ecological issue with these pythons. "The invasive Burmese pythons are doing very well in Florida's preserved wetlands. Pythons have no natural predators, and they are threatening Florida's native snakes and mammals. The United States Geological Survey, or USGS, estimates tens of thousands live in South Florida. The snakes are destroying local wildlife. In one 2012 study, the USGS found that populations of raccoons had declined by 99.3%, opossums by 98.9%, and bobcats by 87.5% since the early 2000s. Controlling this hungry snake, scientists say, is a critical goal. More than 600 hunters took part in this year's challenge. Their goal is to beat last year's top total of 209 pythons killed. The hunter who kills the most wins $10,000. The competition is designed to create understanding about Florida's python problem. It has succeeded in doing that. The event has drawn famous people and has led to some reality television shows. But the need for python control remains urgent. Since 2017, Florida has been paying about 100 contractors to catch the snakes year-round. That project is shared by the Wildlife Agency and the South Florida Water Management District. Through 2023, more than 18,000 pythons have been removed from the wild. Contractors like Acock have removed about 11,000. The pay is average. Hunting along back roads pays $13 an hour. walking through the swamp, pays $18 an hour. Contractors also get paid per snake, $50 for the first 1.2 meters in length, plus more for longer snakes. You're not going to make a living doing this full time. There's no way you could do it, Acock said. Florida does not permit hunters to use firearms to kill pythons. Catching them is a hands-on exercise. Acock goes into the wetlands to check on known hatching spots and grabs at them when he can. But mostly, he drives down empty roads at night, shining a strong light into the swamps. He says these bug-filled drives help his mental health. Sometimes he brings along fellow members of the Swamp Apes, a mental health nonprofit organization for veterans. The group catches invasive snakes in the wild, clears overgrown areas, and works toward environmental preservation. The group's founder, Tom Rahill, is also a snake hunting contractor. He knows the swamp so well that he can smell a python's musk odor. He says he can feel when a snake is near. There is an art to catching a snake, the hunters say. The methods change from hunter to hunter. Some use a snake hook and then jump on them before putting them into bags. Rahill likes using his hands if the snake is calm enough. Instead of jumping on the snake, you just kind of gently get up to it and then just pick it up, he said. But the snakes are not always calm. Sometimes a hunter needs a helper to keep the snake uncoiled until it calms down and can be contained to prevent escape. Once the snakes are caught, the hunters have 24 hours to take them to the wildlife agency. It is illegal for any person other than a licensed contractor to transport a live invasive snake. Acock takes them home first to be humanely killed. That's the part of the job that I really just hate, he said. I hate having to kill snakes. I'm Ana Mateo.
In this week's episode of Everyday Grammar, we are going to talk about conditionals. We use conditionals to show that something is true only when something else is true. Conditionals offer endless possibilities for creative and imaginative expression. The present real conditional is the most basic kind of conditional. Basically, when A happens, B happens. Here is an example of a present real conditional. If it rains, I bring an umbrella. Conditionals have two parts: the if clause, if it rains, and the result clause, I bring an umbrella. You could also say, I bring an umbrella if it rains. Poets and songwriters often use conditionals in their work. Listen for the present real conditional in this song by American songwriter Bob Dylan.
If you see her, say hello. She might be in Tangier.
Notice that the verbs see and say are both in the present tense for the present real conditional. The next conditional that we're going to talk about is the present unreal conditional. Use the present unreal conditional to talk about what you would do in an unreal or imaginary situation. If A happened, B would happen. For example, if I were you, I would take the job. The key word is would. It makes the conditional unreal. Would can only be used in the result clause of the sentence. Here's an example from American singer Johnny Cash. To form a present unreal conditional, use a simple past verb in the if clause. In the result clause, use would followed by a simple present verb. Use the verb were for all nouns in the if clause of the sentence. For example, if she were an animal, she would be a cat. In informal speech, people might say, if she was an animal, she would be a cat. But you should avoid this in formal writing. Now let's talk about the future real conditional. If A happens, B will happen. To make a future real conditional, use will in the result clause. For example, if your plane is late, I will wait in the car. Use the future real conditional to talk about possible situations in the future. Speakers sometimes use the future real conditional to threaten others. Listen to actor Liam Neeson in the 2013 movie Taken. In this scene of the movie, Neeson's character is on the phone threatening the man who kidnapped his daughter. This is only a quick introduction to conditionals. In a future episode of Everyday Grammar, we will talk about past and mixed conditionals. Until then, we will leave you with country music stars Johnny Cash and June Carter.
If you were a carpenter and I were a lady, I'd marry you anyway. I'd have your baby.
I'm Jonathan Evans. Words in this story. Conditional, noun. A word, clause, or sentence that shows that something is true or happens only if something else is true or happens. Imaginative, adjective. Having or showing an ability to think of new and interesting ideas. Having or showing imagination. Basic, adjective. Forming or relating to the first or easiest part of something. Clause. Noun. Grammar. A part of a sentence that has its own subject and verb. Tense. Noun. A form of a verb that is used to show when an action happened. Unreal. Adjective. Not real. Not true. Now it's your turn. Do you like to use conditionals? If you write a sentence with a conditional in the comments section, we will let you know if it is correct. Or tell us which kind of conditional is in the previous sentence.
VOA Learning English has launched a new program for children. It is called Let's Learn English with Anna. The new course aims to teach children American English through asking and answering questions and experiencing fun situations. For more information, visit our website, learningenglish.voanews.com. Today, we visit a national park that stretches across two southern U.S. states, Tennessee and North Carolina, and two mountain ranges, the Blue Ridge and the Appalachian. The area is known for its wildflowers, autumn colors, waterfalls, and black bears. It is also known for the blue-colored mist that hangs above mountain peaks and valleys. It looks like smoke and gave the area its name. Today, we are exploring the Great Smoky Mountains National Park. We are hardly alone on our journey. The Great Smoky Mountains National Park gets more visitors than any other.
Starting in the 1920s, local citizens began working to protect the land. Ann Davis moved to Knoxville, Tennessee in 1915. She soon came to love the Great Smoky Mountains. In 1923, Davis visited some of the national parks in the western United States. She proposed creation of a national park to protect the Smokies after she returned home. Ann Davis entered politics to help push the idea. In 1925, she became the first female from her county to serve in the Tennessee State House of Representatives. She proposed a bill to permit the purchase of more than 30,000 hectares of land from the Little River Lumber Company. That was the first huge purchase of land used to create the national park. In 1934, Tennessee and North Carolina gave the federal government more than 300,000 hectares of land for the park. The Great Smoky Mountains National Park was established on June 15, 1934. But the official dedication did not take place until 1940, when President Franklin Roosevelt spoke at a ceremony within the park. The ceremony took place at the Rockefeller Monument on the border between the two states that provided the land. Roosevelt said that day, "It is good and right that we should conserve these mountain heights of the old frontier for the benefit of the American people."
Most years, around 9 million people visit the Great Smoky Mountains National Park. It is the largest area of protected land east of the Rocky Mountains, and it is one of the few national parks that is free to enter. The park has over 1,000 kilometers of trails, more than 110 kilometers of the world-famous Appalachian Trail cuts through the Smokies. So, you might share the trail with a hiker in the middle of a months-long walk from Georgia all the way north to Maine. Visitors also share the park with a large population of black bears. The park is one of the biggest protected areas in the eastern U.S. where wild black bears live. Black bears once roamed a huge part of North America, but the populations suffered because of habitat loss. Scientists say around 1,500 black bears live in the Great Smoky Mountains National Park. park officials work hard to protect them and warn visitors not to get close to bears or leave behind trash that would harm the bears.
Many visitors come to the park to view wildlife. One of the most popular places to do so is in an area called Cades Cove. Here, visitors can see white-tailed deer, the dog-like coyote, turkeys, and yes, black bears. Cades Cove is a valley. It has a long and rich history. The Cherokee Indians used to hunt there. The first European settlers arrived in the early 1800s. In the 1830s, around 270 people lived in Cades Cove. Today, many kinds of historic buildings and structures remain in the valley, including log houses, barns, churches, and a working mill. Cades Cove is also an excellent place to view wildflowers. The park is famous for its wildflower diversity. Within the park are more than 1,500 kinds of flowers, more than any other national park in the country. Another famous spot in the Great Smoky Mountains is Klingman's Dome. It is the highest point within the park. At the top of the 2,024-meter-tall mountain is an observation tower. It offers viewers a 360-degree view of the Smokies and surrounding areas.
Unfortunately, the park has faced air pollution problems. The pollution harms the views atop Klingman's Dome and other scenic spots in the park. The Cherokee Indians who lived in the area used to call these mountains Shakonaji, which means place of the blue smoke. Today, the blue-gray smoke that surrounds the mountains is no longer pure. Some of it is just air pollution. Most comes from electric power centers and cars. The pollution damages native plants and water streams. It also affects the views from the scenic overlooks. It can make the mountain colors appear less bright and beautiful. The National Park Service suggests that visitors by car consider using public transportation from the city of Gatlinburg, Tennessee. A trolley car takes visitors to many stops within the park. The millions of visitors to this beautiful part of America have a special responsibility to preserve the land that many worked so hard to protect. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Katie Weaver.
And that's our program for today. Join us again tomorrow to keep learning English through stories from around the world. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter Jr.